What's up, everybody? Is everyone joining in? Got a night of Nock On Elevate rests. This is what we got. We're gonna give some time, like always, for some people to join in. But it's a blizzard here in Iowa, so I decided to bring you down to our little, my little resting area, my area of peace down here. Got some mounts behind me. This is like a kind of our family veg out couch right here, and we've got like a nice theater projection screen behind you. So we came out here with a little portable area that I do a lot of work on. It's pretty cool. A lot of you out there were asking about stands for the X-Press, and this, actually, I got this at Costco. These are awesome. You can get them for $300. These are great for an X-Press. You can lag an X-Press right on the back of this. That's what I have over at my other place. And then you can roll it around all you want to. It fits on perfect. This side has drawers, so you can store a lot of your tools and everything over here, or a lot of your accessories, and then walk around and work on your bow. But yeah, for the price of what some of the actual stands cost, you might be better off just finding a really cool cabinet like this. So, got people joining in, everyone there. First off, I want to say thanks for getting a Nock On Elevate rest. I bet you some of you out there did not get one, or any of you not got one today. Unfortunately, I think because of the weather, some of us didn't get one, me included. This actually isn't even a production rest. The only production rest I have is on Joe Rogan's bow down there. This rest was actually an earlier generation, and it's just a piece of paper I printed off to show you guys what your packaging looks like. So sorry if it didn't make it. I know AAE got hundreds out this week, but with the weather, unfortunately, we're a little bit late, but we're still gonna jump into this. Because I haven't got my production rest yet, for those of you who got your rest, you know that in the package there was a little piece of paper that told you to go to YouTube and just search Elevate Arrow Rest Setup. I haven't done it yet because I actually want to use the real package and exactly how it comes out of the package, so I'm going to have to do that in the next day or two. But tonight, I'm gonna give you the walk down. I'm gonna run you through everything that you need to know in order to set your rest up. And again, this really is the most universal rest out there. There's so many different ways to set it up. There's so many adjustments that you can make. And it's almost difficult to make the directions as accurate as we need to. So, before I get started, are there any questions rolling in that would keep us on topic? I know a lot of you guys will see how this goes, how much time this takes us to walk through these arrow rests, but hopefully by the time we're done, you guys will understand this, understand how they function, how you can adjust them. And you know, last week I actually did a full setup and tuned with the rest. And I'm going to do more of that in the future, but tonight's broadcast is really specific towards just getting this rest, understanding how it moves, understanding the functions, and really getting a feel for how much adjustment that you can make to it, really walking through each individual screw more or less and how it works. And ideally, the name of the game is, a year from now, I want to have all of you out there watching to be able to do what I do, really. I mean, I want you to be able to flow through this stuff, and eventually I want to be able to do a live podcast, but just have some of you guys here and do it for me, and I'll just watch and partake on a Yeti cup. So I do have a Yeti cup. If you're under 21, it's water. If you're over 21, it's a mystery. So all right, let's get started. Any questions about initial setup?
Paul Hatch asks, can you show how to take off the caption bar all the way and installing the blade?
All right, so come on over, James. For those of you watching and who are a Nock On Nationer, we've got, you might recognize the name, James Jeanette. James got invited in. He's done an awesome job of following and sharing and all that stuff. So tonight James is running camera. It's not the best job in the house, but we'll do other fun stuff. So I've got a couple rests here. I'm just going to go ahead and unpack this one. This is what most of yours should have looked like. Again, we've got clamshell packaging coming. I was forced with, do I get you guys a rest before Christmas? And for those of you who got your target bows early, or do I wait for good packaging? So last week we took the vote and everybody said, screw the packaging. So screw the packaging. But when you take this out, when you take your rest out, what you should have is you should have the half cage on the rest, just like this. Half cage also comes with the full cage. So I set this one up right now with a full cage. It has a little drop down door right here if you want to do that. But really, all you have to do, and I've got one set up already with the blade so that I can go back and forth to show you guys. But Paul, I'm going to get to that. Guaranteed, I'll get to that. So I think the best thing for right now is for me just to walk through this arrow rest and just show you really how everything works. So when you take this out of the package, you're going to notice that this little side lever arm right here is part of, this is actually your lever arm. This will go to your bottom limb. And if you're going to use a limb driven, you would actually hold it down, pull the cord tight, tighten that little set screw that's right there on the end, and your rest would stay down. Then as you drew your bow, your limbs would bend, your rest would come up. The rest should come to you set with this right here at about 40 to 45 degrees. Ideally, it's going to be in about that position. I like it in that position for hunters, okay? I specifically have the whale tail at a higher position because when you're starting to shoot down, I still like it to cradle that arrow. But this is your lever arm here. If you want to change out your pieces, there's two small set screws here on the bottom. The two silver ones actually hold on the blade. That holds on the whale tail, which we call that, okay? But the two underneath, those two right there are the set screws that go onto the main drive rod. Now on this drive rod, and I'm gonna show you how easy it is to take these off. So I'm just gonna partially loosen both of those. You'll see this comes loose and it'll just slide right off. Because this is magnetized, you know, this will actually stay on there when you take it on or off. If you don't want this arrow holder, people, you can slide this off, remove the arrow holder, and just put this back on. But when you put it on, the important thing is there is a flat spot on this rod. Can you see that, James, the flat spot?
Yeah.
Okay, so there's the flat spot. When you tighten down your screws on any of these brackets that hold the launchers, you always want to make sure that you're tightening those down onto the flat spot of the rod. Okay, that's going to be important. So I'm just going to go ahead and tighten this one down right there. Now, if you wanted to shoot a launcher blade like this, then what you may want to do is you might, which this piece right here should be in your kit. You should have this piece right here in your kit along with a short wide blade like this. That'll come with it. This is for indoor arrows. This is for outdoor arrows. They're in a 10,000ths. You can also buy different blades, different thicknesses on the website, knockonarchery.com. You can get this in 8,000ths, 10,000ths, 12,000ths in either a standard, a freak, which will fit an X10, or the wide. So you've got really 9 different blade choices you can choose from. So what you want to do if you want to set it up for target is I actually like to, you know, loosen these two screws and I'll slide this off. Okay, I'll just do it with this one right here. So I'll loosen these two screws, right? Just a little bit. Got it go just enough so it clears the flat spot. Slide that off. Then from there, you have access right in here to these small little screws that hold the cage on. There's two of them, right there, right there. Now you should get a long extended Allen wrench with your kit so that if you want to slide it in there and back this out without removing this, you can. What that allows you to do is what you've noticed on the cage, there's actually a slot here. So you can slide this cage up or down depending on the height that you want it. I personally, when I start, I would loosen these just a little bit. And for everyone out there, keep in mind this aero containment is plastic. It's probably the only thing on this rest that's breakable other than the blade. I actually prefer on my hunting bow with my Hoyt is I'll slide this up and then I'll tighten those down. They should come that way. They should come with the cage higher. But if you don't want the cage on, all you have to do is back out those two screws and this cage will come off just like this. And you'll have two small screws just like these right here. So there you go. If you remove your cage, that's what you're gonna have. Then if you remove the cage and this, that's what you're gonna have right there. You're gonna have that. So at that point, you can slide this on. You can adjust this left or right, depending on what your best guess is for center shot. And then when you have that, again, tighten those down all the way onto that flat spot, okay? And then you've pretty much learned this bracket system. Now, if you want to replace a blade, this is really easy. We actually made this so that replacing the blade, and in the future, actually, the whale tail will actually fit this exact bracket. We'll have whale tails in the future that'll fit the same bracket, so you don't ever even have to change your bracket if you don't want to. But you'll be able to just take off this one big screw right here. And when that screw is out, you can see here that there's actually an octagon right there. That octagon allows you to take this blade out. And if you broke this blade during a tournament, you could put a new blade on there, you could tighten that blade down, and it's going to hit in the same spot as long as you buy the same length blade, because they do actually have I don't know if I have one right here close, but they do have, yeah, I do. They do have this blade. It does come in a short and in a standard, which the standard is longer. So if you did replace it with a longer blade, it is going to hit different. But if you replace it with the blades that come with it, which are the shorts, you're going to hit right in the same spot. It's really nice. If you ever break a blade, all you have to do is put that blade back on that octagon right there and put this screw and the washer on. Tighten them all the way down and tighten that all the way down tight, and that blade is totally ready. That's it right there. So, okay, from there, I'm just going to talk about a few things. In this packet, when you take your rest out of the packet, let's just talk about some of the stuff that you're going to find in that packet. Okay, when you take that rest out of the packet, again, you're going to have your full containment cage. You're going to have your arm with a blade. Who's here? Harry? Hey, dude.
Hey.
And then you're also going to get some felt pads, some little felt pads like this. These felt pads are multi-purpose. You can use these felt pads to either put them on your whale tail and then trim them. If you fold them around the whale tail and trim them, or it also comes with this right here. This is a Teflon cover. So the way this works is you peel it and it actually will fit inside of your whale tail. If you take the sticker part off, and then all that folds around, and this is a Teflon sticker that folds on the inside and sticks on like that. Okay? So you have the choice for either felt that you can trim, or you can use that Teflon. The other thing is, with this arrow holder, okay, this arrow holder has a magnet underneath. So some people are worried about the sound when this flips around and that magnet hits. Okay, you can hear it. If it doesn't have any silencer, that's about as loud as it is. So if you're worried about that noise, then all you have to do is flip this back, and you want a super small piece of felt, and all you have to do is stick that felt or a real thin piece of Scotch tape or 3M Scotch tape on that magnet, and it'll just block this enough to where it comes around, it's silent. And I don't know if I've, let me see if I've got mine done. Yep, so this here, I have mine done underneath. There's a small piece of felt underneath. I don't know if you can see it, but it's pretty much a black felt right there over the magnet. So when this comes around, you can hear it doesn't have that slap. That's much quieter. And when your rest is up, it doesn't have to come as far around to hit either. I haven't had it bust any deer with me, but if you're worried about it, what's nice is you do have a full containment if you would like one. You also, in your pack, it comes with a sticky riser or a sticky riser pad, so you can peel this off and you can stick this on the inside of a riser. The Hoyt risers are already dished out, so they always cradle your arrow to the center, which is really, really nice. But if you have a flat top like a Matthews or an Elite, something like that, then this sticky pad may be a good option for you. You're going to want to make sure that this arrow cradle part is at the front of the riser, not at the back. Have it at the front. And if you need to trim any of this here with scissor, you can easily trim that. I don't have to worry about any of that. So that's pretty much what your rest is right there. The one thing I'll tell you, inside of your baggie, you're also going to get a main bolt to put your rest on. And there's also a set screw, this silver screw right here. Can you see that? This silver screw is your secondary set screw on your arrow rest. And what you'll notice is, if it's not flush with the inside here, like if it's already screwed in a little bit like this one, you don't want that, because it's going to end up causing your rest to jackknife when you tighten down this main bolt. So what I want you to do when you grab your rest, the first thing you should do when you take it out of the pack, decide what cage you want on it. And also, do you want, you know, a whale tail? Or do you want to end up just making it strictly target for now? That's really up to you. But let's say you want a full containment whale tail with the arrow holder. Okay, so if you're in this position here, next thing you should do before you mount this is you're going to want to make sure that this right here is backed out enough to where it's not going to cause this rest to jackknife when you bolt it down. So I'm just going to back this secondary set screw out a little bit so that it's flush on there. Then I'm going to put it on the riser. I'm going to tighten this down. And what I like to do is you want to back that screw up a little bit till you feel it click, then you start to turn it in. You never want to cross thread a riser. That's a nightmare. So this particular bow is an older Hoyt. You know, I personally, if I were to set this up, I would push it back to where it's touching this web. The newer webs go back a little further than this old one. This is actually the bow that I competed with back when Sharon and I were hot and heavy. So I made a bow and named it out after. This is a bow that I shot in Europe. This was old Blondie. So got let me think of Sharon when I was on the road. A lot of guys are saying freaking D-bag. But all your wives that are having to watch this right now, they're like, aw, I like that guy. See, that's what we're trying to do, keep the wives happy tonight. So we've tightened this up. This is flush. This is 90 degrees parallel. Okay, once this is good and tight like that, then you want to snug down your set screw. Then you want to snug down the silver one right there. So this one first till it's tight, make sure your main bracket bar here is parallel. Then you're going to tighten down this secondary one just a little bit, maybe half a turn or so, and then your arrow rest is on, and that's it. The one thing I want to tell you guys with this lever arm right here is, you know, you have the option to somewhat adjust the spring tension if you want to. However, I'm going to take this apart. I'm going to show you something about this. But the main thing is, if you're going to shoot this as a limb-driven system, you want this. We made this to where this is pretty foolproof, because the older style rests, which is actually what I still have on my bow, the older style rest had a teardrop system like this. Okay? Just to show you, this teardrop system, depending on your left to right adjustment, could interfere with the main bracket. The other thing too is it makes it hard to load the spring and turn it to the right spot and crank this down. So the brand new one that I've worked with Nick to get done is this one right here. Brand new shape. Okay, so whenever you're putting this on or working with your springs, which we'll talk about in a little bit, I want you to keep in mind that this is set up to where it either goes this way or it goes this way. Okay, if it's facing forward like this, it's set up to where when you pull down on it and you tighten that cable, this is going to go to the bottom limb. If you want to change it to go to your top limb, I'm going to show you, you're going to back this out. You're actually going to turn it around 180 degrees. You're going to reset it on the spring. You're going to move it up and tighten it down to where it's actually pointing back. That way you pull it up to the top limb, which is going to lower it. So if this arm is facing forward, you got to go to the bottom limb. If you flip this to where this is pointing back, then you can go to the top limb. Everyone got that? Good. Okay, so here's, before we get into actually changing that lever arm, I'm going to talk to you guys about the simple things, okay? Simple things are left and right adjustment. So on these arrow rests, the top screw right here adjusts your left or right, okay? You loosen that, then you have the option to either roll this little guy with your finger, but you gotta have a small finger. Or what you can do is right here on the side, there's a small set screw. You can see where it says counterclockwise moves it to the right. This is a micro adjustment. So counterclockwise will move it right. Obviously clockwise will move it left. But, and you look right here on this arrow. So as I turn this, it's going to micro adjust this left or counterclockwise. It's moving it the other way. Everybody good? So what I like to do, everybody, just so people listening knows, is I like to put my arrow rest on my bow like this, and what you'll see is for this particular one, it's obviously way inside. This is on the inside of the riser, it's too far in. So what I'll actually do is I'll kind of get my main adjustment done by loosening these two set screws that we talked about earlier. I'll loosen those two set screws. If anyone's making any relevant questions, James, make sure you tell me. You're the man in charge tonight. If you don't answer people's questions, they're going to punch you in the face the next ASA shoot. So see, I've adjusted that left and right so that when I pull this down, it's in the center of the riser, which on these Hoyts, that's going to be pretty dang close to center shot, okay? So now I'm going to just use the micro adjustment for minor left and rights. I'm not going to use it for the majority, okay? But it is important that whenever you mount this side lever arm, if you ever change it from upper limb to bottom limb, or if you want to slightly adjust the tension slightly because you're shooting a launcher blade, you want to make sure this is either going straight forward or more or less straight back. Because if you set this up to where this lever arm is up here, then what will happen is when you try to go too far to the left in your micro adjustment, this will end up touching that block. So you have to be mindful of that. Make sure that that lever arm, anytime you mount it, it's supposed to be below your main mounting block.
Daniel McKenzie asks, do you have to use the limb cable if you only use the blade?
No. So if you're using the blade like this, I think a lot of people will probably shoot their target set up just like this right here. You'll more or less remove your cage. You'll put your mounting block on. You'll kind of figure out your best left and right. Then you're going to tighten those down tight. And from that point, the only thing you really need to do is with the whale tail, remember, I've got this coming to you from the factory with that whale tail sitting at about this angle here, okay? Now with the target setup, what we're going to find is we're probably going to want to lower our blade angle a little bit more to about here, 35, 38 degrees, okay? We're not going to want to be in this position. We're going to want to be about here. So in that situation, which I'm just going to go ahead and show you with this, you know, let's say this blade angle's too high, okay? So here's what you guys can do. What you can do in that case is you can take your lever arm and you can move it down to where your blade is at the position you want. So let's just say your blade position's about right there is where you want it. When you have that in the exact position you want for your blade angle, then let's snug down this bottom set screw right here. You don't have to do this, but if you want to, you can snug that down a little bit. And that'll pretty much hold your blade angle, okay? That's a little severe. Let's just say right there is where we would want it. It's still a little bit low for my preference, but if you're shooting a 12,000th blade, you might want it a little bit less because you're not going to want it so stiff. So if you're in that position there, then what you want to do, because what affects your blade angle is actually this small little collar right here. This collar is held on by this set screw. This set screw comes up and touches this peg right here. Now I have a silencing, it comes to you for hunters, it comes with you a small piece of PVC that silences this so when it comes up it's not metal on metal. So if you're a hunter, you can keep that on there. For most of you blade shooters, you can keep it on as well because it's not really going to be smashing that. But let's just take that off for right now, okay? You can see because I've tightened this set screw, it holds this from moving. And what I've showed you is when it's in this position, the lower angle, this set screw is not touching the peg. Okay, let's see. So you can see there's a space between here, which we don't want. I'll show you that. So if I loosen this bottom screw, that holds it, that goes up. You can see now it's touching, but the blade angle's steep. So what we want to do is we want it touching. It always needs a touch, but it needs a touch when your blade angle is where you want. So I'm just going to lower that blade angle a little bit again. I'm going to snug down this just a little bit. Don't tighten that down so much that you end up smashing it into this rod. Just enough to hold it. From there, take your Allen wrench. You're going to loosen this collar. Okay, you can see that this set screw now allows this collar to spin. We're going to push it against that rod. Again, the blade angle is where we want. It is locked down because of that. We're going to push that against the rod, and then we're going to make sure that it's tightened down. Now that should always be tight. You don't want that coming loose. That always should stay tight. And you should get an Allen wrench in your packet that specifically fits this. And one thing I want to tell all of you out there is, it's important that I keep one set of Allen wrenches that are good Allen wrenches specifically for working on parts of my arrow rests or parts of my sight that take a really small Allen head screw. Because the ones that are in my quiver, I use them so much, these start to get rounded off on the ends. And if these are rounded off on the ends, it gets really easy to round off these set screws, these smaller set screws on things. So have a good set of Allen wrenches and make sure you have a nice square set. Push it all the way till it stops and then use those set screws. Okay, so I've moved the collar to where that set screw is hitting the peg. Now I'm gonna loosen this bottom up just enough. And from there you can see we've got a new blade angle. The spring tension isn't enough to where this is gonna push out of the way. So you really don't ever have to lock that down. If you don't want the actual spring of the rest to happen as a secondary, and you want to be a target archer that just has a blade in a permanently locked position, then all you have to do is set your blade angle where you want, make sure that's tight, and tighten down that bottom set screw, and you're completely locked. It will not move at all in that position. Now we talked about how to adjust your left and right. To adjust your up and down, it's actually this screw right here on the side. So this screw right here, where that Allen wrench is in there, that screw right there loosens that, and then this bottom, you can hold it with your finger, this bottom right here micro adjusts your up and down.
So McGeegan asks, why does it make a difference in blade angle?
Okay, so blade angle is important because if you're a target archer, again, we had three different stiffness of blades. We had an 8,000ths, a 10,000ths, and a 12,000ths, okay? The 8,000ths would be very, very floppy. Now you can almost adjust how easy that blade bends by making it more vertical. It'll obviously be stiffer, or if you start to lay it flatter, it will be weaker, okay? So what I found for me is if I take a 10,000ths blade that's a little bit stiff, and what happens is if you have a blade that is too stiff, then it causes what I call catapulting. And what catapulting is when this blade, when the arrow comes through, the arrow has a paradox. Grab this arrow. So when the arrow passes through the bow, you have a launcher right here, okay, as it passes through. Well, when you fire, your arrow flexes, okay? It has an archer's paradox. With a compound bow and a release, this bend goes straight up like this, okay? It's gonna come up like this, then it's gonna start to bend down, then it bends up, then it down as it flies through the air. So what happens is when you shoot and this starts to load the arrow like this, it pushes down on that rest. And if the rest is in too steep of an angle, With too stiff of a blade, it doesn't give. You actually want there to be some give on the rest so that as it's propelled through there, the rest kind of absorbs some of that and it allows the arrow to ride down through that rest, okay? Now, if it's too steep, what happens is it starts to push this and it springs back. It doesn't give enough to ride the arrow like this. What happens is it barely pushes on it, and then a lot of times the arrow's about right here when it flips back, and that's what gives people the high terror. It takes slow motion photography to see it, but as that arrow flexes and as it's coming through, it's flexing, and then as it's getting here, that rest is just kicking back up and it hits the back of that arrow. It's similar to what happens with a standardized cable driven fall away. See, the original fall aways, they actually were different than the limb driven. The limb driven, they're down all the time, right? And then as you draw and the limbs bend, they come up. Now with the cable driven system, it's opposite. And what happened was a lot of people, as they shot forward, as they shot, the arrow rest would go down so fast and then it would bounce back up. And a lot of people were getting high tears that they couldn't get rid of. They were always going through the paper high. And it's because that rest would hit the thing and there wouldn't be anything holding it down. So it would hit and it would pop back up right about the time and flick the back of the arrow. But then it would eventually go back down. It took slow motion photography to see it. With the blade, it's the same thing. If you're having a high tear through paper, a lot of times you can change that on a target arrow. One, it's a sign of a weak spine. However, it's also a sign of contact, whether it's contact on a vein or specifically contact on an arrow crashing against that rest. Now, a lot of people shoot feathers for indoor setups because with those stiffer arrows, a lot of times when they're coming through, they've had contact with the fletchings and the feathers bend out of the way and they're a lot more forgiving. And a lot of the newer style launcher blades, like the Freak blade that's really, really close together, that's set specifically for like an X10 arrow that has a very, very small diameter, okay? Because they're wanting to make sure it gets perfect clearance going through. You know, if you had a really big lizard tongue that was as wide as that, and you had an arrow like this, and you're trying to shoot through, obviously you're contacting, okay? But if you have an arrow rest that's like this, you can see it actually is small enough to where that can clear as it glides through. And that's what target archers want. They want clearance. The problem is, a hunter isn't going to want to fiddle around with having to keep an arrow on that little blade. Now, this blade's a bit small for an arrow of this size. An arrow of this size would probably need that standard blade. A bigger indoor arrow would definitely take that wide blade. I've given you one of each, so you should be able to make a choice what works best for you. But that blade angle is going to be critical. And again, if you want to lock it into position, you can lock it. Personally, I actually like not having this fully locked, even with the blade, because we have specifically set these rests to where when you do what I told you, and if this right here is set up to where it's, to where when it's mounted on there properly, that blade angle, when it's at a 45 with this rest, when the blade angle is like this with your whale tail, this is going to be flat, parallel, okay? Now, you do have the option to slightly adjust that, like we just did. If you want to put a blade on there and have the ability to do that, you can. But when you're shooting this whale tail, I really prefer you to have it in that 45 degree angle. It cradles that arrow much better. Okay, so there's your blade. We've talked about how to adjust that collar there. So now let's talk about a few other little things with this rest.
Sean Maslowski asks, will AAE sell the clamps separately, the limb clamps?
So here's the thing. We're not going to stock every single part for the rest. And that's a big part of why I'm picking partners to work with, one, that are great companies and stand behind their product. Carter, 100% stands behind Noctuits and Silverbacks. You know, there's a ton of them going out there. Every now and then, there might be a spring that lays sideways when they tighten it down. If it doesn't work out, all these companies are going to take care of it right away. You know, you get it back to Carter, they're going to fix it right away. You know, if you need them to pay for it to send it back, the main thing is they're going to stand behind their product. Same thing with AAE. If you have a problem with this, if anything fails, if something breaks because of a manufacturing problem, they are going to stand behind this rest. If you break something, if you need a small little part, AAE is going to have it. You can call in. They're certainly going to take care of it. It's a big part of why I'm working with the companies that I am. In the same packet, if you want to take this rest, okay, and if you want to make it a cable-driven system, if you do want to hook it to your cable, you're going to use this little bracket right here. This little block is pretty much a sandwich. Okay, you have two small Allen or Phillips head screws. You'll have a small, like the same kind you use on glasses. That's a really good one to use on this because you won't actually round them off. If you do buy a small little screwdriver, and I wish I would have brought mine in here, that goes in there, I can tell you a tip that I learned years ago. Was if you buy a little screwdriver for this, and this same type of screw like this is on several different parts in the industry, a lot of different sandwich clamps like this for cable systems. I know some of the older TrueBall releases had that same size screw. If you buy a little screwdriver, what I can tell you is take the tip of it and just touch the tip and flatten the tip down just a little bit on a belt sander or on a file, because it actually prevents you from rounding out these. It fits in there and it locks in a lot better. But if you back both of those out, you actually clamp this around the cable. From there, you can feed the steel cable. You can feed this steel cable. Or if you want to on these rests, you also have the ability to use loop cord. If you wanted to use loop cord, we made these holes plenty big for you to do it. You can change out colors if you want to customize it. If you don't want to use this steel cable, which I highly prefer, I love this steel cable, works awesome. This steel cable works great. It hasn't stretched a bit. Again, this is one of the original ones. I really like it. If you don't like this one, then you can easily change it out to a loop cord, easy enough. But this sandwich clamp right here is going to go on your bus cable, your power cable, which is the one that goes up to the top limb and splits. If it doesn't do that, it's going to be the one that goes under your axle on the bottom cam. This one right here. You would put this sandwich right here. I personally like to put them right beneath my hand, right about here is where you'd want to put it. You could run the cable. Mess here. You can run the cable through there. There's a small little set screw. Guessing that's the one. Yep. You would just tighten this down onto your cable. Okay. You can always trim these off. But you have the ability to either pull the slack out of your cable either on the limb clamp, or you can pull the slack out of your cable on this top part of the bracket. Personally, when I set up my bow, I actually like to take my steel cable and I will feed it through the limb clamp. Okay, this is the limb clamp for a split limb bow. This is what your limb clamp set looks like. All you have to do is take these black screws all the way out. If you take them all the way out, then you can put this around your limb and you can tighten this down. Okay, I'll just show you.
Bronco wants to know, how do you reset the springs? Can you show how to reset the springs?
Yeah, I'll get there, Bronco. You chill out. Just kidding, Ryan. So this is Rogan's bow right here. You can see how I put it on there. Nock On. If you're a Hoyt, I kind of like to go right in line with the cam. You want to make sure that you have it over far enough to where your cam totally clears these limb clamps if you're doing a split limb. Okay? If you have a single limb, there's actually a bigger bracket. And, of course, I don't have a production one, so I don't have it. But there's a wide clamp that comes in the packet, like if you have an older straight limb style bow. In that particular case, you're going to want to put that sandwich and move it as far away from the cam as you can towards the bottom part of the V of a straight limb. I don't have a straight limb here, but if it was a straight limb, there'd be a V down here. You'll want to slide that. Let's just say this is a sandwich. You would want to slide that as far down to that V as possible, and you're going to run that bolt through there and tighten it on. The main thing is on this particular bracket here, you're going to slowly tighten each side equally until that compresses. Don't crank down just on one side and then start really having to reef the other side, because you can break this. You can break that in half. I mean, if you keep tightening it, you will smack it in half. So you want it snug, you want it tight enough to where it's not going to move, you know, plenty tight, but you don't want to break it. If you do break it, you're going to have to call AAE. Tell them you got tough arms and you broke it. So that's pretty much what one will look like totally set up right there. I can show you. I took this clamp, I mounted this cable through that bottom clamp, and I tightened it all the way down tight. Then I took the long end of this cord and I fed it through this hole right here, and there was a whole bunch of excess sticking out the top. I grabbed this lever arm, I pulled it down so that the rest is flat against the riser. You don't want to smash it. If you pull this down too far, it's going to continually bend that whale tail until it breaks. So you want it to come down, but you don't want to break that. So have it to where it contacts it, and as soon as you've pulled it down to where it contacts it, you're going to pull that slack out of that, and you're going to hold that and tighten that set screw right there, and it'll stay in the down position until you draw back, and then it'll come up. Okay? So let's just talk about real quick. I'm going to show you how this lever arm works. Okay, let's just take one of these here. Doesn't really matter which one we take. We can take this one. So let's talk about this piece here. Okay. So this piece here, nothing major is going to happen if this blows out. We talked about pretty much all these screws. This small screw can adjust your up and down. This tightens your block for your left and right. That moves your left and right. This is what loosens or tightens to hold down your up and down. Now this lever arm here, we've got this small set screw here that's in the front of that piece. That is what your cable will feed through. Okay, now I've tightened this up because if you're set up to shoot a launcher blade, which this one was, I don't want that screw rattling, so I just snug that screw down. But if you're going to set it up for like that limb driven system, again, you would feed your cable through there. Okay, and you'd feed your cable through, you'd push this down to where it's the rest is flat on the riser. You would pull your slack out of your line, and then you would just tighten this small little set screw right here on your lever arm. You would tighten that down, and then your rest would stay in that down position, and you can then trim off some of this if you'd like. Personally, I save just enough to where if I loosen this and let my rest up, I still have enough here to where I can feed it through and pull on it. Okay? Don't cut it really close, because if you ever change to a different length axle or something like that, you're going to wish you had more of this. So leave a little bit there. Okay? So now let's talk about actually changing this lever arm position. Do you have any more questions coming in, or am I answering them as we're going?
Yeah, you're kind of answering them as you're going along.
We kind of got a big block party over there. Shades over there, neighbors. We cooked probably one of the best bone-in pork loins I've ever tasted in my life. And obviously we're having fun, but we're committed to you guys. We want to have a friendly neighborhood Saturday party night, but we're talking arrow rest right now. So let's talk about this side piece.
Trevor Courier asked, what gauge is that cord?
I don't know gauge. I just know that this is a steel cable. It's coated, so it's not going to rust, fall apart. I just really like this because it's not too thick. You know, I can pull it, and I've had this on several different bows, and it hasn't stretched at all. One of the problems with some of the other rests that I've had is the cord eventually does stretch. As it stretches, obviously the performance is going to change of the rest itself. So let's, oh, babe, you got, Sharon's watching me on her phone while she's watching me live.
Garrett Huster asked, can you get more cable from AAE?
Yeah, you can always get more cable from AAP. Anything that comes in this rest, AAE is going to hook you guys up. Don't worry about that. They're a great company, totally stand behind everything. So let's talk about this lever unit right here. You know, this is a pretty easy unit. So there's really two screws. There's one screw right here. There's a set screw here. And the way this was built, everybody, is this set screw, there's gonna be a set screw on this lever arm, and there's also gonna be a side tension screw on the lever arm, okay? With this set screw, there's two holes on this lever arm. One hole is here on the bottom, and one hole is up here at the top, okay? If you're going to the bottom limb with your limb drive cable, then you want your set screw here on the top, okay? If you're going, let's just show you here quick. So I'm gonna loosen that set screw. Now, if you want to, while you're working on this, you can snug this bottom one down if you want to hold your rest in your position. It's up to you, you have that choice. So if we take this side one out, you wanna hold this, people. Okay, if you take your side one out, a couple things, there's a washer there, you don't wanna lose that washer. Okay, set that upright. And again, we've loosened this set screw. Now we've taken this side one off. So this is gonna come right off, okay? This is gonna come off and there's gonna be a spring in there. Now this particular spring right here is a spring set specifically for limb drive, okay? Trying to look here. Somewhere in your pack, in your bow pack, I'm not for sure this is, okay, so in your bow pack, you're gonna get another spring like this. Now this spring, you can see is actually, this spring is different. This spring goes the opposite direction, okay? This spring that's in this baggie is for people that want to go to their cable. If you want to go to your limb, you use the one that's in the rest. Okay, so now I'm going to show you quick here. In your arrow rest, there's a very small screw in this corner up here, the upper right hand corner. There's a little hole right there. Okay, when you take your spring, you want your spring to go in that hole. If it goes in that hole, then it fits down in there. If it's not in the hole, it's not gonna fit in there. So you want it in that hole, right there, and then that whole thing goes down in like this. Now remember, I told you that if we're gonna have a limb-driven system going to the bottom limb, then this arm here will face forward like this. Now if we're gonna have a limb driven that goes to the top, this arm we're gonna be wanting to face back, okay? Now what's important is you'll notice that on this rod here, there's also a flat spot. The flat spot is on the top right here, okay? That's important because when we design this, to where when you take this, and you can see there's two holes on the inside of this piece. There's a hole there, and there's a hole there. Okay, so this is made to where the tighter you tighten this, the more you'll bend this spring, cause more spring tension. Okay, so what we want to do is we have to apply some tension always so that this rest works. So if we're going to do a bottom cable system, we're going to take this, and ideally we want it right here. We want it facing straight forward, this arm facing straight forward. And if you'll notice, when that arm's facing straight forward, this set screw should bite down on the flat part of that. So what you're going to do is you actually have to line up these holes to where the hole will the spring will go in the hole, okay? Can you see that, James? I want to tighten this a little bit so it ends up right there. So I'm actually, the way these holes are designed, they're designed in a perfect spot. Can you see the hole in that? The hole right there? Okay, so I'm going to take that hole. I'm going to put it inside there. I'm going to take this. And I'm going to turn it, and I'm going to push it against, I'm going to push it all the way down like this. So you can see this, as I do this, if you've done it right, this should get tighter the further down you push it. But what you want to do is you actually want to line up this set screw on that flat spot. So I'm just going to move that set screw to where that flat spot's going to be. I'm going to tighten that down just a little bit. Okay, now what you don't want to do is you don't want to have a big gap here, okay? You don't want space there. That should be fairly good tolerance, which is why we have this screw here. This screw here goes in, okay? And when that screw goes in, it'll slightly help push that over. Now, if you've completely tightened this set screw as hard as you can, then you shouldn't be doing that. But this needs to be somewhat loose. Okay, and you can almost move this just enough to where you feel where that flat spot is. That flat spot on this particular rest is right there. Okay. And you're going to tighten this side one down just enough to where you take that slack out of that. Okay, and then we're going to snug this one down a little bit. You don't ever want these coming off. I'm going to go ahead, since I've made a change, I'm going to loosen this bottom one because I've got my change made, and you can see now this functions, it moves perfectly. It's underneath this bracket here. If you don't want this, I'll show you quick what'll happen. So if we've loosened this to where we have this sidearm and we've tightened it to where it's right here, see how it's touching this block? You don't want that, anybody, okay? This is set up again so where your arm is really running parallel. And that's important because when it's in that position, well, And the reason I like to lock the bottom, if you don't have the blade to hold onto while you adjust this, then that's when I like to lock this. That way, if that's locked, I can adjust this spring tension anywhere I want. Right there is good. There, and then I can loosen this. Now it works just fine. Perfect. So if I wanted to change this around, all you do is you loosen these, take this one out all the way. You able to see all that, James?
Yeah.
Okay, you'll take your side one out. Don't lose your washer. Remove this. This is going to come out. Then from there, what you want to do is, one, if you're going to do this to where it goes to the top limb, because I know like Ryan Bronco was saying he wanted to run his to the top, then you need to take your screw and move your set screw on your bracket to the top side where that lever arm is. So if you're going to the top limb, you do need to move this screw. Okay, and that way, again, this is going to have to be pointing back. So you kind of look to see where the other screw hole is. You know, put it on there, you're going to move it back. It's on there. Put the side screw on. And do that. You're gonna move this up till it's in the position we talked about. Right there, it's actually seating down on that flat top spot of that bar that I showed you earlier. I'm gonna re-snug this just a little bit so that we don't have a big gap between here. If you crank down super, super hard on these, you could cause the rest to not be able to freely move as much. Now that we've got that done, I'm gonna let off this screw on the bottom, and now this can be pulled to the top and your slack can be taken out. You know, this would go to the top cable now. So you would pull this up to pull your rest down. You'd feed this through, tighten it up, and now you've got an upper limb drive. Okay, if people, you can back up, they may be freaking out, they're too tight to that rest. They might want to see my face again. They may not, but if I was looking that tight for a while, I'd feel like a scientist looking through a microscope. So I'm just going to go ahead and switch this. If you want to, you see how easy that is. So if you want to go to a cable-driven system, all you need is that spring right there that's in this little baggie. If you put this spring in, then it's a reverse spring, and it's made to go to the cable, okay? So I think that's pretty much it. Does anyone got any questions at all about the rest? Again, I'll grab my bow. If you go to last... There's two things that I built, everybody. I built the Prevail, and I also built this Pro Defiant. On both of those builds, we put arrow rests on, right? Yeah, thought so. So on both of those builds, we put arrow rests on. So if you go back through the live feeds to the Hoyt Prevail build or the Pro Defiant build, you can probably find both of those on the Nock On Archer YouTube channel as well. You can search those. I did a full setup, everything, knocks, rest, the whole deal. I personally, again, if you wanna know how I'm set up, this is my personal bow right here. I'm actually shooting an Easton FMJ, a 3-inch AAE Max Stealth Vane with a nocturnal lighted nock. Unless I'm in Montana or someplace that doesn't like lighted nocks. I'm actually shooting 100 grain rage. From there, I've got my Nock On rests. I'm personally shooting Rattler grips. Show you the Rattler grips there. Handsome Rob, he's probably somewhere lurking around the feed. He makes some awesome grips. I had a lot of questions today about stabilizers. So, or today, a guy actually sent a message to me on the Instagram board asking about stabilizers, if I talk about those tonight. So, forgot your name, buddy. Sorry. Here's the stabilizer I use. This is actually just a Hoyt torch. I believe this is the 8-inch. And I actually get this. I custom order this part. This is actually off one of the older fuse. I don't even know what this is called, but it has a tapered rubber. I don't know if it's truly a doinker, but it's similar to a doinker. Evan Williams, if you're watching right now, tell everybody what that part is. But I actually like this because this is a decent amount of weight. I'm a firm believer in, I like having practicality of a stabilizer. A lot of people nowadays are just wanting the weight. They're wanting to add weight. But I actually like something that gets rid of my vibration. Because it has that rubber there, this actually eliminates or dissipates your remnant vibration as it, you know, because when you shoot, energy goes from your limbs to the center of the handle, and then they try to find a way to go out either end. So as it comes down, it goes out, and then this helps dissipate any of your residual vibration out. Okay, now that's what I personally like. It's an 8-inch fuse torch, okay, with that little extra deal. Now here's Rogan's setup. Rogan's actually shooting the multi-rod. He's got a fuse bracket. He's tried a ton of different stabilizers, but he's got this one on his Pro Defiant, loves it, wanted this one set up. He actually likes a lot of physical weight. He's more worried about the physical weight than the vibration. So he actually is still shooting the stock torch weights. So this has a bunch of different weights with rubberized discs that does still help with some vibration. Just in my opinion, I just really, really like it even quieter yet. So I personally like a little bit less vibration in my setup. This has a quick connect. The back doesn't have quick disconnect. The front does, just for travability in the case. But that's how it is. He likes some little bit of weight on the back, but this is important. I like to not have so much that it's interfering with me. So if I'm in my shop process, you know, and I'm sitting here, this isn't coming back so far that I'm not actually able to keep my bow down. See, Joe knows that part of the shot routine that I taught him was being able to relax the front shoulder. So because you want to relax that front shoulder, if this is coming back so far to where you have to hold it out like this, you're never relieving tension off that front inside part of your delt. So this is nice because you can actually still keep it close to your body. I have like a little belt that hangs down where I set my bow on there. This can stay close to my body so I can still use my binoculars. Or if I'm just practicing going through shot routine, I can tuck this in between my leg. It's not hitting. His weight isn't super far behind the bow. It's closer to the center. I'm a big, big fan of that. This is a really, really sweet setup. I actually feel like I can probably shoot his bow, even though it's 3 inches shorter than mine, every bit as good as mine.
Trevor Corey asks, is there any downside to using the whale tail for outdoor 3D versus blade?
No, actually I was talking to Ryan today about that. Ryan asked me this. Ryan was actually going to set up a launcher blade with a cable drive, which is something I want to work towards. I don't know if we're there yet, just because, however, if these blades are smashing down on the riser continually, remember, this is spring steel. So is this. This is spring steel. However, now the new ones, if you had one of the very first AAE rests. I know some of the very first ones had a few of these spring steel blades break. However, some of the very first ones did not have a backer, meaning you can see there's actually a small backer. Now, you may want to take this off of your whale tail if you're going to shoot a limb drive. Well, you won't be able to right now, actually, simply because this is a two-hole, I guess. This is a single hole, but you don't want to push that too far down hard on your riser. But this whale tail is perfect for especially a 3D arrow. I mean, this is a perfect size for like a 2315 all the way up to a bigger shaft. I'm really not so convinced that I might not actually just shoot this standard hunting style rest for a Vegas setup. So I might do that, actually. I might reset up my Prevail with, well, I'm going to set up a bow with this for my indoor arrows. I don't know which one it's going to be, but I'm going to do it. Okay.
You're at 20%.
What's that?
20%.
Okay, we're at 20%. The main thing is, if you ever take this apart, if you ever break one of these, there will be replacements. AE's got replacements. Make sure you always put this piece underneath. In the future, these replacement whale tails will actually have the octagon piece. So not too far down the road, we'll be able to buy these with an octagon piece. So if you set it up with one single bracket, you'll be able to change to any blade. You'll be able to switch out, rock and roll. All's good. I'm trying to think.
Will there be a clamp for like Elites or the Matthews Halons?
So the single, I talked to AAE and they told me that the single piece, the full wide limb piece, should work fine on that. That's what they made that for. I personally don't have one because I knew mine was coming for a Hoyt. I was hoping I'd actually have the production rest here so that I could show you, and I would have taken that clamp out and actually put it on a Matthews. If Greg Poole's watching, Greg, I don't know if you're like playing with your buffalo bow or whatever right now, but if you're watching, maybe chime in, let people know on that. But this whale tail is what you need. Make sure you always have that underneath. Don't be afraid to use this for indoor. I'm telling you, this thing is so consistent. It's so dependable. This is just an awesome, awesome rest. You guys are going to love it. If you're an international person, yes, we do ship internationally, but you have to email info@knockonarchery.com. You can't order on the website, no matter how many different tricky ways you try to enter an American address and then call us later. That's not the way to do it. You got to email first. We'll get you hooked up. And we're actually waiting for inventory. We had ordered a big amount to come here so we could actually ship the international orders. That box was supposed to be here yesterday. It wasn't here. It wasn't here today. Hopefully it's here Monday and we'll start shipping. Other than that, did I miss anything, babe?
Well, you'll probably do a podcast.
Oh, wait. Oh, yeah. If I miss something, I'll do a podcast. New shooter shirts. If 1,000 people buy them, I'll shoot Vegas. Just kidding. 5 people buy them, I'll... No. I might shoot Vegas. Keep you people guessing. We'll see. We'll see how it goes. But I know you guys are asking, knock to its, we were expecting some in already. There is a jillion-y people wanting knock to its, and they're coming. Those of you who actually went on the website, clicked on this, and went in the notify me tab and put in your email, you are going to get an email. Probably 2 days after Christmas, maybe right after Christmas. But when you get that email, you better be ready. Save some stocking money, because when they're gone, they're gone. We can't hold them. But that's the only way to get on the list, is to go on there. Same thing with the silverbacks. We're getting a whole bunch of these first, although we already know that there's less coming than how many of you have your emails in, so act fast. But we do have another batch coming after the fourth batch of these come in. So these should be here somewhere around the first to second week of January, probably closer to the second week of January, but silverbacks are coming. This one's Harry's. Little Dud, he put some wood grain duct tape on his and told me not to touch it. But since there's a blizzard outside with a half inch of ice and we weren't able to go to the school, and we're down here in my video room, I had to borrow Little Dud's just in case I had to do anything with it. I already dinged it. So other than that, any main questions you've seen, James?
Bronco said hashtag Vegas or bust.
Of course he did. Of course he did. Well, the good thing is today we've had some good food. What's the question?
Will the limb clamps accommodate 7/8 limbs like the Matthew Hollins?
The Halons?
Halons.
Yeah, they should. So if listen, all of you out there, you guys are really, I mean, we're in this together. So if at any time something doesn't work, all you have to do is let us know. I guarantee you, I couldn't have picked a better company to work with. They will get you taken care of. And if we need to make any modifications at all to this, there's something that I've missed, we'll make it happen. Don't worry about that. I'm certain. I'm super happy with this rest. As you can see, I mean, there's so many options what you can do with it. I'm super happy with it, and I'm hoping all of you guys out there are in the same. We really wanted to make sure that it came in at a price less than the other premium, premium priced micro adjustable rests that have super good tolerances and machined aluminum. So that's what we did. I guess I learned that James Jeanette does probably the best Schmeagle impersonation I've ever heard. And yes, you will have to do that at some point for people, dude. He was good at it. So thanks, everybody. Any other questions? Anybody? Nothing major? Sorry it wasn't as like cool as the setting where I was moving around, but we had to get this aero rest figured out, and I'm going to do a video so you can watch this again. I'll also post this on YouTube. Any questions I don't get to, we'll get to in a podcast. Thanks, everybody, for sharing, and I'm sure I'll see you again. Let's do this again. We'll do some shooting. Pay attention. I don't know when, but I'll do some. We need to get in and do some shooting. And actually, late season, I get to start hunting again in 2 days. So here's what we're going to do. Stay posted. When I'm freezing cold and bored to death in one of my green redneck blinds, let's go live. I might let you guys tune in to one of my late season doe tags for a little live feed. I'm going to try to figure something out. So if you see Nock On TV's going live from the stand, you better hurry up, because I won't wait too long for you to get there. So thanks, everybody. Appreciate it. Don't know what else to say. Have a good weekend. Make sure you stay safe, and hug your family, and stay in bed late tomorrow. See ya.